That was a mild interruption due to network. I'm sorry for that. I want us to continue our discussion. God's wisdom for overcoming the stagnant situations of life. God's wisdom for overcoming stagnant situations of life. Have you ever been in a situation where it seems like you are trapped? You cannot go forward. You cannot go backward. Have you ever been in a situation where it appears as if you are trapped? I have been in that condition before. You cannot go backward, and yet you cannot go forward. That is a stagnant situation. God has a wisdom for you this morning. And I want you to listen to me with rapt attention. So we have been able to establish the fact that God's word is God's wisdom. God's word. And so now, when we talk about God's word is basically divided into two. The Logos, and the Rhema. Logos is the written word. When you pick your Bible and you read John chapter 1, that is the written word. Rhema is the spirit behind the letters. That is when God takes a scripture and it applies to your situation. It appears as if that scripture was written for you. And it just comes at a time that meets your need. John chapter 6 verse 3. Jesus said, "The letter killeth, but the spirit giveth life. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So the entire scripture is full of logos. But when the Holy Spirit breathes on the scripture, it becomes rhema. And so you can read the same scripture 1,000 times and get 1,000 different meanings and revelation from it. So, another definition of God's wisdom is this. Now, we have established that God's wisdom is God's word. Now, let me take it further. God's wisdom is God's customized strategy for solving a particular situation at hand. Customized strategy. In other words, my wisdom is not your wisdom sometimes. Your wisdom is not my wisdom. The wisdom God gives you to solve a problem might not be the wisdom God is giving me to solve the same problem. The same problem. 10 different people can have the same problem, and God can give them 10 different wisdoms to solve that problem. So if you copy and paste your friend's wisdom, it may not work for you. Many of us are master at copying and pasting people's strategy. Your friend does not have a job. He had to go and start a business. He's selling gas or selling whatever. And he has become very rich. And then you copy that model and things are not working for you. What do you say to that? You have not received your own rhema from God. You are copying another man's rhema. So God's wisdom is God's word. And number two, God's wisdom is God's customized strategy for solving a particular situation. Now, there are different types of wisdom. I wrote in one of my books, there is a wisdom for marriage. There is a wisdom for sound health. There is a wisdom for career excellence. Even though the Bible, God's word, is the overall system that houses all of these wisdoms, you still need access into that wisdom. As a Christian. So there are different types of wisdom. But the one we are looking at this morning is the wisdom of God for overcoming the stagnancies of life. Stagnant situations of life. Stagnant. And I'm going to read a scripture here. I've just given us the foundation of what we're saying. I'd like to tell you this morning, there is no situation in life that can overcome the wisdom of God. There is no problem of life that can overcome the wisdom of God. There is no amount of trouble or crisis or problem or hunger or poverty that you may have that can defy the influence and effect of the wisdom of God. In the book of James, chapter 3, James, chapter 3, verse 15, the Bible identifies different types of wisdom: sensual wisdom, earthly wisdom, satanic wisdom. There are different types of wisdom, different types. Satan also has his own kind of wisdom. Have you heard this statement from people? I use wisdom. I will tell lies. I will call that lie. It was the wisdom of God. I use wisdom to get that thing. I actually use wisdom. What we are saying is that we use satanic wisdom to get that thing done. Because the wisdom of God, the Bible, if you read the book of James chapter 3, it is a pure wisdom. It is pure. The wisdom of God is pure. Anything that makes you to tell lie, to sleep with somebody to get a job, it's not the wisdom of God. It is satanic wisdom. You have applied satanic wisdom many times. They have not worked for you. It is time you access the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God is pure. It is pure. Read the book of James chapter 3. You will see the categories of the wisdom that exists: sensual, earthly, devilish, and godly wisdom. So I am promoting godly wisdom this morning. I am promoting godly wisdom this morning. I am not promoting satanic wisdom. Then there is earthly wisdom. There is sensual wisdom. There is a wisdom that we collect and we acquire when we go to school. And that is a very important wisdom. The people that design the electricity we are using, the cars we drive, the computer systems, the mobile phones, they deployed their God-given wisdom. It's a natural wisdom or earthly wisdom. It is a very important wisdom. We cannot function on earth without the earthly wisdom God has deposited in us. The know-how, the capabilities, intellectualism, they are very important. We have all gone to school. If you have gone to secondary school, you have gone to school. You have used some methodologies. Somebody has taught you how to add 1 plus 1 to make it 2. How to add 10 plus 10 to make it 20. These are earthly wisdom. It is very important. I am not discountenancing it. We need earthly wisdom. But there comes a realm. There comes a stage in life when earthly wisdom gives way for the wisdom of God. There are situations of life that cannot be resolved by earthly wisdom. Professors of medicine are confused about cancer, HIV. They cannot solve that problem. They have earthly wisdom. Their earthly wisdom cannot cure cancer. Earthly wisdom does not chase out demons. Earthly wisdom does not heal people. Earthly wisdom is different from God's kind of wisdom. And that is what we are discussing this afternoon. Now, I want us to read a particular book in the Bible, Exodus chapter 14. It is a long stretch of scriptures. And I'm not going to read everything. This story captures the departure of the children of Israel from Egypt. The night that they left Egypt, they passed overnight. And then they crossed over. Exodus chapter 14, verse 1. Now the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel, that they turn and come before Pi-Hahiroth, between Migdol and the sea, opposite Baal-zephon. You shall camp before it by the sea. Verse 3. For Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are bewildered by the land. The wilderness has closed them in. Verse 4. Then I will add in Pharaoh's heart, so that he will pursue them. And I will gain honor over Pharaoh and over all his army, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. And they did so. I'm going to jump to verse 10. Now, I want you to listen to this statement and I'm going to make after this verse now. And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. The children of Israel cried. They had spent 430 years in Egypt. They had been impoverished. They had suffered. They were beaten. They were humiliated. They were ostracized. They became a pariah state in the land of Egypt. And after all the signs and wonders that God used Moses and Aaron to perform, the night came for them to leave. And they thought that everything was already settled. And they went on that journey, glorious transition, great breakthrough. And they looked back and lifted their eyes and saw the marching host of the Egyptians, led by Pharaoh himself, rolling after them. In front of them was the Red Sea. Behind them was Pharaoh. They were trapped, so to say. They were trapped. They couldn't go forward. They couldn't go backward. That is a stagnant situation of life. And I want to ask you this afternoon. I have been in such situations. And like I gave them as an example in church. Here is a woman that had been waiting for God for the fruit of the womb for 25 years, 20 years, 10 years. And God just blessed her with that baby. And she was at the brink of giving birth to the child. And something happens. And the doctor is telling you, we are going to lose the baby. We either save the mother and lose the baby, or we lose everybody. The woman cannot go back into the realm of barrenness. She had suffered barrenness for 10 years. But she cannot go forward. Because if she decides to give birth to that child that time, it will take her life. And the doctor is giving her to choose. Do we save your life and you lose the baby? Or will the two of you die at the same time? What would you choose? It is a stagnant situation of life. You have been unemployed for 5 years. You left a university. You made a good grade. And you got this job after 5 years in a big company. And you are celebrating. And on the day you were supposed to resume, something just happened. There was a particular fraud. There was a particular corruption. Something happened and probably you had even resumed and you were placed on probation. But you have not been confirmed. And somebody implicated you. And the company you're working with, maybe a bank, decided to fire you. They are not just going to fire you. They are going to blacklist you so that every other company will not be able to employ you. And you begin to think, what is wrong with me? I have been unemployed for 5 years. Here am I have just gotten a job. I cannot go back to unemployment. I cannot go forward in this job. Stagnant situation of life. I have had such experiences many times. And from time to time, we get into such stages in our life where it seems like though we are trapped. You cannot go forward. You cannot go backward. You cannot go forward. You cannot go backward. There is only one person that can solve that kind of a problem. It is God. It is God. When you get to the limit of your wisdom, when you get to the limit of your skill, of your talent, of your natural capability, the only thing that can solve that kind of a problem is the wisdom of God. So the children of Israel, they were trapped. In front of them was the Red Sea. Behind them was Pharaoh. Do we go back into Egypt and continue our suffering? Do we plunge into the Red Sea? Look at what the Israelites did. Please pay attention to this scripture. I'm going to read verse 10. This is exactly what you and I would have done. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. They cried out to the Lord. In other words, the children of Israel prayed. Maybe they went to a mountain, hypothetically, and fasted and cried. We are trapped. Lord, save us. That would have been the decision I would have taken if I were in their shoes that time. What is wrong in crying out to God when you are in a stagnant situation? What is wrong in crying out to God? That is the best thing. Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 3 says, call unto me and I will show you great and mighty things. I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you don't know. So they were in a stagnant situation and they cried to God and they prayed to God. I was expecting God to answer that prayer and to do something miraculous and push the children of Israel into the sea or create a room or whatever. Look at what God said here. Verse 15, Exodus chapter 14. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? I was shaken when I read the scripture. You are in the middle of a crisis. Behind you were your enemies. In front of you was the ocean. And you cried to God in prayer. And it's like God is saying, keep quiet. Why are you praying to me? How does that sound to you? I am just reading the scriptures here now. I didn't make this up. God said to Moses, why are you crying to me? Like God was telling the one, keep quiet. Keep quiet. Why are you praying to me? These people were trapped. In front of them was the Red Sea. Behind them was Pharaoh. And the children of Israel cried out to God. The normal thing to do in a situation of crisis is to cry to God. But God is speaking here. Verse 15. Exodus chapter 14. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Why are you crying to me? And I asked the Holy Spirit, is it a bad thing to cry to you when we have problem? If they didn't cry to you, who should they have cried to? Who should they have cried to? Why did you question the Israelites' effrontery? Why did you question them? How could God tell people that are in crisis and they are crying to him? Why are you crying to me? Why are you crying to me? That statement blew my mind and I went into research. I said, Lord, this statement is disorganizing my theology. Are you saying that we should not cry to you in prayer? If you don't pray to God, who do you pray to? If God is saying, do not cry to me on an issue, what do you do? Any problem God cannot solve, nobody can solve it. Any crisis God cannot resolve, nobody can resolve it. So what do you do? And the Lord said to me, God wasn't saying that prayer is bad. God will not violate the scriptures. God will not violate the scriptures. These people were trapped. These people were trapped. They were stagnant. Like you and I have been stagnant in many times, in many situations in our lives. And in front of them was the Red Sea. Behind them was Pharaoh. Listen to this. Let me tell you the secret now. Listen to this. Why are you crying to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. The Lord said to me, even though prayer is a potent force, prayer is an effective weapon to solve every situation, to resolve issues, to win battles. It is not the master key for solving every problem at every time. There is a time to pray. There is a time to act. Did you hear that? There is a time to pray. There is a time to act. If you act when you are supposed to pray, you will not win the battle. If you pray when you are supposed to act, you will be a failure. So there is a time to pray. There is a time to act. God was telling them, you need wisdom. You need wisdom. What you need now is the principal thing, not the vice principal now. Because the Bible says that wisdom is the principal thing, not prayer is the principal thing. Because it's possible for a man to pray and to pray amiss. The Bible says that you can be praying wrong set of prayers. I know many prayer warriors that are poor, not because prayer is bad, but because they are praying foolishly. They are not backing their prayers with appropriate corresponding actions. The Lord said, why are you crying to me? Why are you praying to me? If this statement had come out of the mouth of a prophet, I would have said it was a man speaking like a man. God Almighty, who ordained prayer. I want us to suspend our theology now. The God Almighty that ordained prayer, who said in Jeremiah 33 verse 3, call unto me, I will answer you and show you great and mighty things. He's the one telling them, keep quiet. This is not the time to cry. This is not the time to pray. Keep quiet. Keep quiet. Listen to my wisdom now. God was telling them, in this situation, in this problem, you are stagnant. You are trapped. You need wisdom. And the wisdom you need are broken into two. Two wisdom. Many of you are going through the same affliction, not because you are not a prayer warrior, but you are not a wisdom warrior. You can pray very well, but you are not wise. I have been there. I am even still there now. I am still trusting God for wisdom in so many areas of my life and ministry. I don't know many things. I know very little. I have been praying. When I'm praying, my hand, anytime I'm praying, my spirit is connected to God. What are you saying? What are you saying? What is the action? What should I do? I don't just pray and carry my problem and pour them on God and ask God to fix them like that. I know it that the word supernatural is a compound word made up of two words, super and natural. God does the super. I do the natural. God does the super. I do the natural. The supernatural will not happen if I don't play my role. Nobody will be saved if they don't voluntarily and willingly accept Jesus into their life. Even though that salvation package is there, Jesus died on the cross. Is everybody saved? There are millions of people living in different parts of the world who don't even want to hear the name of Jesus. So if you don't consciously accept that package of salvation, that salvation is not automatically bestowed on you. What am I saying here? God's wisdom for overcoming the stagnancies of life. You do not pray when you're supposed to act. You do not act when you're supposed to pray. You need access to customized wisdom. Access to customized wisdom. You need access to customized wisdom. Your wisdom is not my wisdom. Many of you are getting married. I'm going to talk about wisdom for marriage probably next week or the upper week. It is the wisdom, the 10 M's of marriage that somebody taught you that you apply. That may not work for you. That was his own light. That was his own wisdom. There are people that God will join together in the plane. There are people God will show their wives in the restaurant. There are people God will show their wife in the canteen. There are people God will show their wives in the church. So because your friend got married to a girl in the church and he told you what he did, you now superimposed that wisdom on your own mind. And so you are looking for a wife in the church. There are devils in the church. There are devils in the church. So if you think that if you marry a man or a woman in the church, your marriage is foolproof, you are deceiving yourself. There is God's customized wisdom for every situation of life. As important as prayer is, as valuable, as potent, as powerful as prayer is, the children of Israel cried to God in prayer. God said, keep quiet. Why are you praying to me? Why are you crying to me? I was stunned. How could God tell people to keep quiet? How could God tell people, don't pray on this situation? A lot of religious people will be mad at me, but I didn't write the scripture. I didn't write the scripture. Exodus chapter 14, verse 15, written in black and white. God came to Moses. Why are you crying to me? Why are you crying to me? Very, very profound revelation. If you can catch this revelation, your journey in life will be easier, will be made easier. You will take personal responsibility to know the mind of God on every situation. You will not just lord everything on God in prayer. There are some of us, any little problem we have, fasting and prayer, fasting and prayer, fasting and prayer, 10 days fasting. You are so accustomed to fasting that you think that you can use fasting to bribe God. Fasting does not affect, it doesn't move God an inch. Forever, oh Lord, your word is settled in heaven. It is we that fasting affects. It puts the spirit above the flesh so we can hear God clearly. And if you are fasting and praying all the time and you have not heard God, you don't hear God's voice, you are going on hunger strike. The purpose of fasting and prayer is to separate yourself, to be attuned to the voice of God so that you can pick that voice and apply that information and instruction you have heard from God to your situation per time. That is why I sometimes get very sad, and I have argued this with many of my friends. A lot of people that are not fasting and praying, they are prospering. A lot of people, the mobile phone in your hand was not made by a Christian. Buddhists, People who worship Satan in Japan and China, they made them. They made them. That is to let you know the capability of every human being. God has loaded every man with potentials. Every man set into the world, born again or not, is loaded with potential. The only difference between a born again child of God and an unbeliever is, number one, they won't have the life of God in them. And they will live through this world, build empires, and die and go to hell. They will not reign with Christ in the life to come. But in terms of the applications of some of their human earthly wisdom, if you are not careful, their earthly wisdom can sweep you off your feet. Because it is God that developed and designed and deposited that earthly wisdom into them. You need wisdom to solve stagnant situation of your life. You need wisdom. God told the Israelites, you need wisdom, not prayer. Do not pray. What kind of prayer would they be praying in front of the Red Sea? When I was in the plane 2 years ago in the U.S. and I was traveling to Canada and there was crisis in the plane, what prayer do you pray? You cannot pray. You lose all your... I was shouting, Jesus. You cannot pray that time. What prayer you pray? When you are in the middle of crisis, in your front is trouble. Behind you is disaster. What kind of prayer? You need wisdom. In a split of second, if you don't get access into God's wisdom, disaster can happen. And Satan knows this, and he does everything possible to deny the people of God access to this wisdom. Access to this wisdom. There is no situation in life that can overcome or overpower the wisdom of God. It is a winner in every contest of life. Wisdom in any position is a winner. If the back of wisdom is on the floor, is a winner. If the head of wisdom is on the floor and his leg is in the roof, is a winner. That is why the Bible says wisdom is the principal thing, not fasting and prayer. If you read my book or my materials on fasting and prayer, you will think that is the only thing to do to go to heaven. So I am not condemning it. Nobody can survive in this world without praying and fasting. I am speaking about something different here. When you are in a stagnant situation, develop passion for knowing the wisdom of God to apply. Don't use prayer and fasting as rubber stamp. Rubber stamp. Every situation, go and fast. Go and pray. Go and fast. Fasting and prayer don't work like that. They are not rubber stamps for dragging God to solve your problem for you. They are not. They are not. Stop going on aimless hunger strikes. Develop the capacity to hear God and to know what He is saying about your situation. You cannot fast your way out of the will of God. You cannot fast your way out of the will of God. You cannot pray yourself out of the will of God. If God is saying, this is my will for you, and you embark on 1,000 days fasting and prayer, you just kill yourself. It will not change God. God is not swayed by what you do. God is swayed by your heart and your sincerity. God is swayed by your heart and your sincerity. Prayer and fasting, they are very good. Prayer and fasting, they are the lifeblood of a Christian. But the Bible says wisdom is the principal thing, not prayer and fasting. Wisdom is the principal thing. Every other thing is a vice principal. Every other thing is a vice principal. If you are wiser than you are today, you'll be greater than you are today. You can only rise to the level of your wisdom. You cannot rise higher than the level of your wisdom. You can only rise to the level of your wisdom. So the level you have in life today now is a reflection of how much of things you know. If you know more than what you know now, you will do more. If God opens your eyes now and gives you access, an idea, develop and design a software that can solve the problem of rain. So that when rain is falling, people can go to their houses and press a button and prevent rain from falling on their own street. And you do it, the whole world will be looking for you. You become a rich man. You become a rich man. So I am not a rich man because I have not had access to connecting to that kind of a wisdom that will help me to solve problem on earth. Regardless of how many years of fasting and praying, it is only if my fasting and prayer can give me access to that wisdom. So fasting and prayer, as important as they are not supernatural magic ones for getting solutions to problems. If you do not know what to do, you cannot fast your way out of the will of God. I'm emphasizing this. The purpose of this teaching is not on fasting and prayer, it's on the wisdom of God. But I can perceive in my spirit that there are people that have been going around the cycle, the same problem. And you have fasted and prayed, and nothing is happening. It is time to change gear. Let God know that you want to obey Him and do His will. Let God know, what are you saying? Okay, Lord. Who is my wife? Okay, what job am I doing? Okay, I have accounting skills. Okay, I have engineering skills. I was trained as an engineer. Although I don't like it, I want to go into business. Okay, no business. Okay, and you settle down. God is sincere. God is faithful. He will speak to you. The children of Israel cried to God. God said, keep quiet. Why are you crying to me? That statement, I thought about it for weeks and days. The same God that told us to call unto him. Jesus said, pray without ceasing. The Bible says, pray without ceasing. The same God is saying here, why are you crying to me? Why are you praying to me? And God gave them two wisdom. I am going to round up on this. I want you to listen to these two wisdom. The children of Israel were trapped. They were stagnant. They were tied down. In front of them was the Red Sea. Behind them were the Egyptians. How did they solve this problem? You need to hear these two things. You need to hear them too. Look at what God said here. Verse 15 and 16. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. Number one is go forward. Go forward. Anything that makes you to stay on the same spot for a protracted period of time is not God. I have said this many times. Somebody has said, look at the five letters in the name of Satan. The first three letters stands for S-A-T, sat, to sit down. Anything that keeps you on the same spot perpetually is not God. Is Satan, is the devil. Look at the first three letters, the first two letters in the name of God. G-O, that is go. Anything that puts you on motion is God. So, if anybody is telling you it is the will of God, God is training you, and you are tied down on the same spot for a considerable number of length of time beyond the usual, don't misquote me. God trains people truly. God takes people through training. I'm speaking of perpetual delay. Perpetual delay. You have been a graduate for 7 years, for 8 years, for 10 years, no job. You have been married for 12 years, no child. And somebody is saying, God is training you. That is a lie. God does not train His children with affliction. Jesus said, if you that you are evil, you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more your heavenly Father? Can your child ask you for bread and you give him a stone? Will your child ask you for fish and you give him a serpent? If you, as evil as you are, you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more God? Can you listen to that? How will God now be happy to punish his children and tie them down for 12 years? With barrenness, it is not God, it is the devil. It is not God, it is the devil. The devil is behind delays, is behind stagnancy. The Bible says in John 10:10, the thief comes not, but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Anywhere you see stealing, you see killing, you see destruction, it is the devil's primary ministry, threefold ministry. But I have come that they might have life. They might have life. Anywhere you see life, you see success, you see breakthrough. God is behind it. Now, I'm going to serve you a caveat here. I am not saying that when people are prospering and they are successful, God is exclusively behind their success. I'm not going to that this morning. There are people who succeed by the devil. There are people who go to Satan for power. They do all kind of things. So I'm speaking now for a Christian, a child of God, who is walking with God, who is serious with God. You are not mixing anything with God. So God gave Moses two wisdom. And this is where I'm going to end this message today. I want you to go home with these two things. Prayer and fasting are potent weapons for winning battles of life. But they are not sustainable in some situations. There are situations of life where you need to hear God. You need to take steps. You need to take responsibility. Irresponsibility is the worst enemy of destiny. Irresponsibility is the worst enemy of destiny. And like I wrote in one of my books, the number one marks of foolishness is you run your life with the mindset that God will do everything. I have tried that before in the past. It didn't work for me. God will do everything. God will do it. God will do it. And God is waiting in heaven. She will do it. I will back her up. She will do it. I will back her up. And you are crying. God will do it. Fasting and praying. God will do it. God will do it. God will do it. And God is saying, when she's ready, she will move. She will apply for that job. She will do the right thing. And when she takes that step, I will back her up. God spoke to Moses. Listen to this. Exodus chapter 14. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. Now, listen to what God said there. Before they go forward, lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. Two principles that will change your life. If you can catch this revelation. Two things. God told Moses, you've got a rod. Lift up that rod. When you have lifted it, tell my children, go forward. Two principles. Lift up your rod. Number one. Number two, go forward. Number one, lift up your rod. Number two, go forward. Every one of us has a rod. You have a rod. I have a rod. Your rod is your strength, your area of calling, your gift, your primary gift, your skill, the core of your life. That is your rod. My rod is teaching and speaking and writing. That is my rod. I have other skills, but the greatest of them is the ability to write and speak. Some people's rod is the ability to sing. They have other skills and talents. But when they sing, all the music producers of this world will be looking for them. Some people, they are too caring. They function well in the nursing, medical, pharmaceutical, care industry. God has given them that rod to rule, to dominate on earth. There are some people, their rod is their leg, are their legs. They have strong athletic grace. They can run very fast, faster than many, and they can run and win in the Olympics. There are some people, their rod is their calculative ability, accounting skills. They just love figures. No matter how complicated that accounting problem is, when they confront it, they break it down into shreds. That is their rod. That is their rod. And God said to Moses, lift up your rod. Listen to that statement. That God didn't say stretch your rod. God didn't say drop. Lift up your rod. Moses' rod was on his hand. God said, lift up. In other words, the level at which your rod is at the moment cannot solve that present stagnant situation. Elevate your rod. Elevate your rod. Your rod is in an uncompetitive state. Repackage yourself. Are you getting it now? Repackage it. Yes, you have that bachelor's degree in accounting. You love accounting. But you have been stagnant for 7 years. There has been no job. But you are very good in accounting. All you have is a BSc. God is saying, lift up that rod. Raise it up. Go and add more qualifications to your accounting. Go and brush yourself up. Repackage yourself. Dress up yourself. Remodel yourself. When you have done that, then stretch it forth on that stagnant situation and go forward and see the path. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? What is your rod? Can your rod compete with the best rod? Something happened when God called Moses. God told Moses, when Moses went into the palace of Pharaoh, Moses threw his rod on the floor. The magician of Pharaoh, they threw their rods. The BSc you have, there are hundreds of millions of people that have the same BSc. What would you do to lift up your rod? God is saying to you this morning, lift up your rod. Your rod is in a crude state. It is not competitive. There is no competitive advantage. You are too common with other people. Go higher. Go a step higher. If I have 100 resumes, I put up an advert for a job about 2 years ago, and I got 500 responses, 500 resumes or CVs, and I selected about 10 of them. I know what I'm looking at. There were some of them, I did not even check them in 1 minute. As soon as I saw the font size, some people use bold letters, bold capitals to do their CV. I didn't want to check what was inside. As soon as I saw the packaging from the outside, I trashed it. There are some I did not even read the content of the resume. There are some I read the content. As soon as I got to a stage, I saw grammatical errors, typos. I just threw it away. There were some that they were equal. Master's degree and another master's degree. And then I looked down and I saw an additional capability. Additional capability in that the other did not have. And I trashed the others and retained that. At the end of the day, I chose 10 out of 500. That is instructive. That stagnant situation, you have prayed about it for months. God has true wisdom for you. Lift up your rod. Your rod is too common. You are a very passionate singer. You write songs. You are very good. The people that win awards to be produced by global music producers, what do they do? Do they just sit down and write songs in their room? Is there an extra skill you can acquire? Is your problem locational? Is it where you're located? Do you need to relocate? The lifting up of your own rod might be a change of location. More than 70% of factors that affect success in life are determined by location. Wrong location may be tantamount to failure. Many people that I know that were appearing to fail in life, as soon as they moved country, they moved city, they moved from one city to another city, and they just took that step of faith, their life just changed. The same skill, the same degree, the same personality, but different location and different results. And different results. Prayer and fasting is not a rubber stamp to get God, to force God to do everything. The Bible didn't say prayer is the master key. The Bible says wisdom is the master key. The Israelite cried to God in prayer. God said, keep quiet. Stop praying. Keep quiet. I need you to do two things. Lift up your rod. He spoke to Moses. Lift up your rod. What state is your rod? Whatever it is God has given you, nobody is sent into this world empty-handed. If you do not have any education at all, start with one. There are so many online programs now that are free. I'm going to do a seminar very soon. And as much as I have time, because of my present engagement, and tell some of my friends where they can find opportunities. There are many places where you can even school now, and they will not charge you any tuition fee. There are many online distant learning programs. They will not write distant learning on a certificate when you finish. So it is not just a matter of cutting your coat according to your size, but cutting your coat according to the available material. If the money you have cannot take you higher, if you are struggling with finances, the little finance you have, the little you have, can still do something. If you reprioritize and rescope your life, if you switch your priorities, you don't need to buy 2 shoes this year. Buy only one. That holiday you normally attend, stop it this year. Divert the funds to repackaging yourself. Just do something different. After the children of Israel had obeyed God, and Moses had lifted up his rod, repackaged his rod, remodeled, rebranded, as soon as he stretched that rod, that stagnant situation in front of them parted way. It parted into two. And God is saying to you this morning, the problem you are facing does not require prayer now. The prayer you have prayed is enough. It is time for action. It is time for action. It is time for action. There are many prayer warriors that are poor. There are many prayer warriors that are struggling. There are people who do not even pray at all that are rich. I am not promoting a prayerless lifestyle. I am a man that prays. I may not be the best prayer warrior, but I pray. So, and I'm not going to teach people error. You must pray. You cannot survive in this wicked world without prayer. But as important as prayer is, the Bible calls wisdom the master key. There are prayer warriors, there are wisdom warriors. The wise man is number one in the book, in the scripture. The wise man. I'm not talking about people with earthly wisdom now. A man that has the wisdom of God, he will rule over a prayer warrior. The man that has the wisdom of God will rule over a prayer warrior that has no wisdom. That has no wisdom. Stagnant situations of life come in different shades. The challenges of life do not have timetables. Satan does not send people advance warning when it's coming. Many of the crises you and I have faced, we didn't know we were facing them. They just showed up. They just showed up. So if you're not prepared and grounded in the wisdom of God to know what to do per time, there are times when the wisdom you need is even prayer. That is how important wisdom is. It's like an umbrella that houses, that covers everything. There are times that the wisdom you need is prayer. There are times that the wisdom you need is not prayer. Ability to balance and to know what to do at the right time. John chapter 6 verse 6. The Bible says, and this he said to prove them. For he himself knew what he would do. Speaking about Jesus. When he wanted to feed 5,000 and he called Philip. Where shall we get bread? The Bible says, and he himself knew what he would do. Powerful statement. When you get to a point where you know what you will do, what you should do in every situation. When you get to a point where you always know what to do, that cannot be by any human effort. You need a greater force to get to that realm, and that force is the wisdom of God. Where you get to any situation of life, no matter how bad, you know what to do, and that thing you apply them and it will solve that problem. The wisdom of God for solving the stagnancies of life. Your rod must be lifted up. And number two, you must go forward. That particular door that you have been knocking, that has refused to open, the rod you are using to knock that door, go and re-examine it. You may need to lift it up. You may need to rebrand it. You may need an additional qualification. You may need to change your dress. You are a woman. No man is asking your hand in marriage. You may be a very bad communicator. You talk to people rudely. You insult people that talk to you. You don't reply messages. You receive texts from people. You delete the text. And you want a man that will commit his life into your hand for the rest of his life. Your own rod may not even be anything complicated. It may just be to discipline yourself. Your own rod may be because you eat too much. You consume too much fat. And that fat has given you additional weight. And no man is calling you to and asking you marriage. Different types of things that we can do as led by the Holy Spirit. Finally, in conclusion, I want to encourage us this afternoon. Give ultimate priority to the wisdom of God in your life. Let God's wisdom be your number one priority. God, what are you saying about this issue? How would Jesus handle this situation? What do I need to do? Take out a day to think. Somebody has said that thinkers and God always meet on the way. Thinkers and God always meet on the way. Psalm 42 verse 7. The deep calls to the deep. When you dig deep, you meet God. Because God is not a shallow God. God is deep. Psalm 42 verse 7. The deep calls to the deep. In other words, the deep always answers the deep. When you are digging deep, you are going deeper. Other people have 2 degrees. You want to have 4. When you take that kind of approach to life and you now pray, it is now easy for your prayer to work than when you are doing nothing and you fold your hands and like the Israelite, you are crying to God and you do not want to take responsibility. Irresponsibility is the worst enemy of destiny. Irresponsibility is the worst enemy of destiny. Like a great man of God said, any faith that makes God to be absolutely responsible over the affairs of your life is an irresponsible faith. The word supernatural is a compound word. Listen to me, God's people. Comprising of super and natural. God does the super. You and I do the natural. If you refuse to do your own, God's super does not make supernatural alone. Because God doesn't want to raise irresponsible children. God doesn't raise irresponsible children. Stagnant situations will always show up. It will appear as if you cannot go to the front and you cannot retrogress. The only way is to go forward. To go forward. And I decree upon you this afternoon, every one of you listening to me, I don't know what that situation is that has defied every kind of solution. In the name above every other name, like the sea gave way when the glory of God, when the glory of God was released through the raising of the rod of Moses, I command every Red Sea standing in your path to give way. In the name of Jesus, whatever Red Sea is standing, let the wisdom of God descend upon you. I command insights, creativity, unique ideas, supernatural foresight to come upon you now in the name of Jesus. Let the wind of wisdom blow upon you. Let the wind of wisdom blow upon you. Let the wind of wisdom blow upon you. Let the wind of wisdom blow upon you in the mighty name of Jesus. Let the wind of wisdom blow upon you. As you sleep tonight, you will hear God. As you sleep tonight, you will see God. The solution to that problem will be downloaded to your spirit. In the name of Jesus, God will organize and reorganize events around your life. And the wisdom you need to solve that problem will be deposited into your spirit. In the name of Jesus, let the spirit of wisdom rest upon you. I command the spirit of wisdom, the wisdom of God, the wisdom of God, the wisdom of God, the wisdom of God. Let the spirit of wisdom envelope you and your family. Every one of your affairs, your ministry, your career, your academics, your marriage, your business, your spirit, your soul, your body, your home, your marriage, let them be enveloped by the wisdom of God. Like that, according to the Lord Jesus, in John chapter 6, verse 6, you will know what to do. You will know what to do. I banish and drive out confusion from your life. In the mighty name of Jesus. Everything representing confusion in your life, I command it to be destroyed. Let the wisdom of God blow like a mighty wind, like a torrent. Let the wisdom of God blow. Let it blow. Let it blow. Receive the wisdom of God. Receive the wisdom of God. Receive the wisdom of God. Receive the wisdom of God in the name of Jesus. Every ignorance, every confusion that the enemy has sent into your life, I command them to be destroyed now by the wisdom of God. Receive that insight. Receive that idea. God will baptize you with unique ideas. Unique ideas. Ideas that will land you into wealth. Ideas that will make you the most competitive. Ideas that will take you to the top. Ideas that will raise you high. Ideas that will seat you with kings. Ideas that will take you to the palace of princes. In the name of Jesus. Every rope that the enemy has used to tie you down, I command them to burst now. In the name of Jesus. Wherever you are listening to me, let the rod that God has given you come alive now. Come alive. Come alive. In the name of Jesus. Whatever your rod is, I command that rod to come alive now. Let that rod come alive. Let it come alive. Let it come alive. Let it come alive. I command life into your rod. Every dead rod, I command it to budge. The Lord is speaking to me that there are some people, your rods are even dead rods. They are dead. You have abandoned that idea. You have abandoned that skill. It appears like they are even lifeless. They are dead. And that is where your glory is. That is where your glory is. There was a time that the Lord asked Moses and Aaron and the Israelites to drop their rods. God said, I will prove to you whom I have called. By the second day, the rod of Moses had budded. Life entered that rod. And it brought out grapes. Dead rod came back to life. In the name above every other name, I command all your dead rods to come alive. Come alive. Come alive. In the name of Jesus. Everyone listening to me, everyone that will watch this video at the end of this broadcast, whatever your rod is, be it your music, your gifts, your degree, your certification, your qualification, whatever it is that represents your rod, your anointing, your grace. Some of you have lost an anointing by virtue of sin or carelessness. You used to see revelations before. God speaks to you clearly before, but suddenly that thing disappeared. Instead of seeing visions in your dream, masquerades are now pursuing you. Satan has hijacked that rod and it appears to be dead. I command your rod to come alive. Come alive. Come alive. Come alive. In the name of Jesus. Let the life of God enter into your rods. Let the life of God enter into your rods. As you wake up tomorrow morning, you wake up as a brand new man. Your rod will bud. 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 In the name of Jesus. Praise ye the Lord. I'm awaiting your testimony. Share your testimony with me. If you need any form of mentorship, guidance, kindly send me a mail, a message via my Facebook profile, or send me a private email at ayoakerele@hotmail.com. We thank God for today. I believe you have been blessed. I've got some of my books here. These are very powerful books that will bless and transform your life. Rediscovering the Power of Spiritual Fruitfulness, an amazing book. You will not drop this book when you start to read it. This is my latest book, God on Mammon, Understanding the Source and Purpose of True Kingdom Wealth. This book is explosive. This book is explosive. The Bible says, buy the truth and sell it. Go on Amazon and order for my books, or send me an email and I'm going to send you as many copies as possible. This is The Days of Noah. An amazing book. Prophetic insight. Sharp prophetic insight. You want to know what is happening in our days and what will happen in the days to come. The days of Noah. And some of the things I preach today are found in this book. This book is loaded. I have not touched one tenth of what is in this book. Wisdom for marriage, wisdom for career, wisdom for prosperity, wisdom for sound health, wisdom for eternity. It is a book you must get. Building and Sustaining a Life of Wisdom is on Amazon as well. And if you cannot access Amazon, because some of our friends are not able to buy books using their credit cards on Amazon, you can send me a mail or a message with your address or as a private Facebook message. And I'm going to respond and reply to you. God bless you so, so much. I thank God for giving me this opportunity to be of blessing to you. And you too, you have been of blessing to me. If you don't watch this broadcast, whom am I going to be speaking to? I really appreciate everyone that has taken time to come on board and those that will watch it later. May God bless you. May God reward you. May God promote you. May God honor you. In Jesus' glorious and matchless name, we have prayed. Amen and amen. God bless you so much. See you next Saturday. Have a great and glorious service in church tomorrow. Bye-bye.